had a wonderful introduction, and I'm not going to call out any of that. But that could be. I'm sorry I'm holding those. All the rest of the speakers who are all men did not. Please don't think this is a gender thing. I'm so sorry, and you know why I said that. Third, a disclaimer. My story is full of Catholic references, but I don't mean to cross the line. I'm one of those actually who object to masses and opening prayers in government agency. And that's going to do it for all denominations. The theme, though, I think is universal. It's common to all cultures and religions. So just think of your own distinction. Okay, I first heard of a walk called Camino de Santiago, also known as the Way of St. James, 9 months ago. I heard about it from an old friend of mine from college and parish, who I had not kept in touch with for many years, but who flew to Chicago to join me in a visit to the former parish priest of ours, who was quite sick. I was supposed to see this priest in June, 2016. I hadn't seen him in 25 years, but he asked me to come in August and care and bring some sick people. Just as I landed, however, I got the news that he had died the day before. The reunion with this priest was supposed to be a kickoff to my first ever sabbatical from UP, where I teach economics. Every 7 years, UP faculty is entitled to a year-long sabbatical. I finished my PhD and joined the academy in 2008, which is 30 years after I graduated from here. So mine was a year overdue. When I filed for the sabbatical, I checked the box that said rest and renewal. There's actually a box that says research project. Why? Rest and renewal. Rest and renewal. But strangely, I forgot to plan exactly how to rest and renew. I knew I had to get out of the country to decompress, to breathe, to find some hope. But I had nothing lined up. So when my friend mentioned the Camino de Santiago, it hit. I dove into the Camino literature, scholar, and found a 1,200-year-old pilgrimage, a network of itineraries across Europe that all led to the cathedral of Santiago de Compostela, a city in Galicia, Spain, where, as Catholic legend would have it, the remains of one of the 12 apostles, St. James the Great, St. Iago, or Santiago Apostol, lived. James was supposed to be one of the closest to Jesus, the man called Jesus, and also the first of the 12 to be martyred. So the discovery in the early 9th century of what was declared to be his remains was of great consequence to Christendom. And the then king of Asturias, Alfonso II, Spain had many kingdoms, declared that a church and a village be built on that site. Alfonso also undertook what he said to be the first pilgrimage to it from his capital in Oviedo. Pilgrims have been traveling to the tomb of the apostle ever since, by foot or horseback, and now by bike. I must admit, I had no special devotion at all to St. James. I did not know much about him, and among the pantheon of Christian icons out there, he simply never interested me. Moreover, I never bothered with formal pilgrimages. I thought they were old school and touristy, and I was an enlightened, progressive Catholic. But the Camino de Santiago seemed different. It was already highly organized by the 12th century, but what had evolved seemed to be driven by the simple faith of pilgrims themselves. There were 7 different ways to reach the city, and these branched out to important sites in the St. James tradition across the peninsula and into the rest of Europe. There was a 100-kilometer path associated with pilgrims from the British Isles, the Camino Indias, who traveled by sea to the northern coast of Galicia and walked the rest of the way. A 1,000-kilometer path that started in Seville in the south, associated with Christians under Moorish rule. There were a couple of Caminos associated with the Portuguese. And of course, the most popular was the Camino Francés, 800 kilometers, that began in the Pyrenees Mountains at the Spanish-French border. There was a movie in 2011 starring Martin Sheen and a documentary by Oprah neither of which I had ever watched. European groups connected to the Camino Francés through France and emanated from Germany, Brussels, and Switzerland. There were also important sea routes, as many pilgrims came from Scandinavia and Netherlands. Medieval Spanish kings supported the pilgrims and consolidated the Camino by building massive infrastructure, bridges, hospitals. Many cities today in northern Spain can probably trace their fortunes to the Camino. Pilgrims would have special privileges to sleep in churches and get free meals. And special paraphernalia identified them. The scallop shell, for instance, which probably began as a souvenir that pilgrims picked up from the shores of Galicia, but is now the symbol of St. James and the Camino itself. Modern pilgrims still wear a scallop shell, but are formally recognized through what is called a credencial, which is stamped in the various cities and villages as one passes through. To get a certificate of completion of the pilgrimage, which is called a Compostela, one had to get 2 stamps for the last a day for the last 100 kilometers in Santiago. It was so well organized in the 12th century that there was even a detailed illustrated guide called the Codex Calixtinus, which provided would-be pilgrims with both practical information, meaning descriptions of the routes, what relics to venerate, what sanctuaries to visit, customs of the local people, even food to eat, as well as spiritual references like music, sermons, texts. This music comes from the Codex that they would meet along the way. Some describe the manuscript as the first ever travel guide. Modern pilgrims continue to visit the places in the manuscript. Apart from the intriguing history, there was also something about the current community of pilgrims that attracted me. Members of the social media forum that I stalked were so generous, courteous, and supportive of each other and of new members of Peregrinos, never failing to say buen camino or have a good journey, and answering questions patiently, even if the same questions had been answered several times over. There are about 30,000 questions on equipment alone in the forum. Questions like, do I wear hiking boots or shoes? Do I wear trail shoes or sandals? Do I use 1 pole or 2 poles? How much water should one carry? Should I carry it in a bladder, in bottles? It was that specific. There were also threads labeled just for the girls' feet. They were very important. Intimate questions were discussed. Hygiene, skincare, moisturizing, underwear, how to wash underwear. Girls know what I mean. It was so very, very informative, I have to say. And reading that, I learned that there was a device that allows women to urinate standing up. I don't know if you've seen it. You actually urinate standing up. Take my word for it, it's a wonderful device. Makes you empowered, you know. Anyway, okay. That's a gender issue. Okay. Of course, the repeated question, is it safe for a woman to walk solo? The overwhelming answer was always, always, yes. But I was never worried about that. Rather, I was anxious about the fact that I had always been a water person. I swim, dive, and at one point even did water ballet. You know, this is not me. I just wanted to make sure you knew what water ballet was. In Sulu restaurant, they used to feature that in the restaurant, the women doing that. Where am I? Okay. I had no experience trekking, hiking, mountain climbing, running. I didn't even own proper shoes for a very, very long time. So the state of my knees and feet were complete unknown. Plus, I am no spring chicken. I'm over 50. Moreover, the route that I felt compelled to do was the Camino Primitivo, the same route that King Alfonso took in the 9th century, which was a 300 43-kilometer walk through mountains with ascents and descents that were incredible. I stumbled upon an account by a hiker from Colorado who had walked it with her husband and who described something that I really wanted, a quiet Camino with less children than the popular Camino Francés of Mount Machine, but with much history and beauty. The trade-off, of course, was less services meaning bathrooms, etc., right? Day 5, for instance, was supposed to bring pilgrims to the ruins of 3 hospitals that were built for pilgrims across the mountains. But that same day, it was not advisable to walk that route if it was foggy or rainy or if you were alone. Pilgrims were told not to do it, is what we say. Okay, to make a long story short, I walked in October, and it was unlike anything I had experienced before. Day 1 was a shocking 26 kilometers up and down on an even terrain. I think two of my toenails died immediately. This was followed by 27 kilometers the next day, which left me sitting on the floor of the shower, unable to move. But I adjusted my day 3 and never got a blister or an injury. And now I am very, very much attached to my boots and my clothes. I really love my boots and my clothes. The Camino was powerful. It pulled me into a simple routine that really was a meditation. Wake at 5:30 a.m. Stretch. Prepare feet. Put on socks and boots. I already had the day's clothes on and slept in them. Repack backpack. Look for open bar. Eat breakfast and be out the door to walk at 7:30 in the morning. Walk, climb, slide, walk. Get to the next stop. Find a bed. Take a bath. Put on clean clothes and wash clothes that have just been used. Hang clothes to dry and pray that they dry. Eat peregrino is pilgrim, eat peregrino meal in the bar, drink, rest, sleep, and get up again at 5:30 the next day to walk. The Camino was also full of mystery. One was simply not alone. Pilgrims and non-pilgrims alike saluted me with Buen Camino as I walked. The signage itself was a tangible mystery. There was formal signage, the scalloped arrow placed at regular points, but there was also informal signage and symbols from pilgrims' path, making sure that we did not go down the wrong path. There was never a time that I didn't find a sign when I needed it. All I had to do was take a breath, and I would see one. It was uncanny and comforting. It gave me a sense a much larger community, a larger universe to which I belong. And for day 5, I prayed for good weather and a companion, and I got both. In fact, I got a whole family. There was no pressure to become a Camino family, actually. No pressure even to walk together, eat with each other, or wait for each other. In fact, I always started earlier because I knew they would all overtake me during the day. I was a slow walker, steady but slow. They called me the Energizer Bunny. Because I didn't stop. Because if I stopped, I'd be too far behind. But we were following the same beat and fell into step with each other, and that beat was a joyful one, particularly after a steep climb. I think we were all just really, really happy walking. It was a happy pilgrimage. You know, all of these people, I thought they were a group that came together. It turned out every single one of us came on our own. The Camino took 13 days. 27 kilometers a day. But even before I landed in Manila, I knew that I was not done. So last April 1, I started walking again. And this time from the south, the Camino Mozárabe, from Almería. It was a tough, long, and solitary 842-36-day walk. I just arrived last week, hence the notes. A different season, a different terrain. Riverbeds rather than mountains, flatter, hotter. My right tendon got so inflamed after day one, I thought it would give out and I was done. There were few pilgrims. I encountered at most 10 the whole time. It's a route that no one has really taken. And in one and even the reassuring signage that accompanied me in the Ontario people was not as present. In one instance, I found myself confused, wandering around the rocks in the pouring rain, looking for the path that someone's GPS said was there. It wasn't. I put down the GPS, said a prayer, crossed the path, and I found the sand. Crossed the rocks, and I found the sand. And the people who I walked by did not seem to know about pilgrims. Were not used to us. And when I would say hola, they would say hola, buen día, which is have a good day. No one, maybe less than five, said buen camino. I honestly don't know why I needed to walk this route, nor for 36 days, nor how I got through it. My friend called me, you know Forrest Gump? You know that time when he just ran? I'm thinking that maybe I needed to see a different face of the Camino. The Primitivo reminded me of the delight of community. This one reminded me that solitude was my friend, my dad's church. The Primitivo gave me a Camino family. This one showed me that companionship could be found where I least expected it, with hospitaleros, or the hosts of the hostels, or even local bar owners, who always had good food, drink, and a football game. Actually, while the Primitivo revealed the wonder and joy of pilgrimage, this one, Mozárabe, revealed the courage that it required. I'm finding that there's a different rhythm and perspective that comes with walking 36 days in near solitude. There is an acute awareness of what one can do and cannot do, of what one is capable of or not when no one is with you. A greater openness and patience with uncertainty and what may come around the next corner. And a willingness to admit to being lost, to cry out for help, to pause and take a breath. But most of all, gratitude for all the small favors, which turned out to be so many, literally. For the next arrow, for making that, helping me make the left turn, for the shade of that tree which was so hot, for the cloud cover without rain, for less than expected distance, for a place to wash clothes, for a place to dry clothes, for finding me a bed. I think it will take courage to make all of that stick now that I'm back home. In fact, courage to go beyond, courage to go higher, was really the traditional wish that pilgrims of the Middle Ages had to require. It is captured in the word "rutea," a salute that goes much deeper than Buen Camino. I learned about it from a lady in Granada, herself a pilgrim, she says, once a pilgrim, always a pilgrim, who said it to me when she saw my backpack and my scallop shell. By crying "Utrea," one is wishing the other to go with courage towards some beyond. Let's keep going, let's go beyond. The other person then replies, "Es Utrea," which conveys the idea of going up, going higher. The complete saying is, E utrea es utrea, Dios ajúdanos. A call to explore what is beyond ourselves with God's help. Let's keep going further, let's keep going higher, God helps. You know, I'm unsure why you are what you're supposed to get out of this story. It's something I have to tell. I'm sure Leo and company thought I'd do something on applied economics. But again, I don't mean to cross the ties. Pilgrimage is a concept common to all cultures and religions as a means of predicting the sacred. As a plea or way of giving thanks, it's universal. What I am more sure about is that most of us in this room will experience
of restlessness, drift, burnout, perhaps even related to your contracts with the school. It happens to the best of us. Believe me, I just found out. I was not the only one who was shifting. Fidel, three, philosophy, and then we found none. It happens to the best of us because there is no presumption that going beyond, forward and higher, always involves smooth, continuous, incremental movement. In which case, if it happens, consider taking a breath, regrouping, risking what to be thankful for, and taking a second look around for an hour or two that may have been missed. Or, come see me, and I'll take you for a walk. Good day.